But now, it's my great pleasure to introduce Steve Curwood. Steve is the executive producer and founding host of Living on Earth. His show has run continually since April 1991 on public radio. Today, Living on Earth is aired on more than 250 radio stations in the United States, as well as on XM Sirius satellite radio each week. Steve's relationship with public radio goes back to 1979, when he began as a reporter and host of Weekend All Things Considered. He learned what he describes as the art and science of journalism as a reporter for the Boston Globe, starting in the days of court-ordered desegregation of Boston's public schools. Steve was born in Roxbury, and his qualifications to speak tonight include the fact that as a child he lived on Humboldt Avenue near the Seaver Street side of Franklin Park. Not only did he think Franklin Park was his backyard, he thought that every kid had an elephant and a giraffe just down the park, just down the block. Steve and I were classmates in college and colleagues at the Globe newsroom for several years. In the past 20 years, no one has covered the climate change story better than Steve Curwood. He knows as much about the environment as any journalist in America. It's my distinct pleasure to introduce Steve Curwood.
It's so exciting to be here tonight with all these young folks who are getting into it, because this is, I got into this business as a journalist, but it has to be some of those early days that had me focus on this story of environmental change. And so, it was cool growing up in Roxbury. Unfortunately, earlier this evening, a group of us, I'm not going to name anybody, but you can maybe guess, were saying, oh, those were the days. But, you know, those were the days. I remember that coming up Humboldt Avenue was an electric bus, a trackless trolley. No fumes, no stink, no noise. I remember that I wasn't allowed to run by myself over to Franklin Park. It was, you know, just too big. But Horatio Harris Park was right near where some friends live on Townsend Street and Walnut Avenue, and we would go and hang out, and that's of course where Roxbury gets its name, because of these huge pudding stone rocks. The park can't be bigger than, I don't know, 2 acres, 3 acres, something like that. And it was great. We just ran all over that place. And it was a time, when I say these were the days, it was a time that a 4-year-old, a 5-year-old, a 6-year-old could go with his friends and a few older kids to a park, and people weren't worried. And one of the things that happened, unfortunately, as time went on, was that when I started to work at the Globe about that time in life, I looked to buy one of those townhouses along there where I'd start my family. And they were cheap. I think $10,000, of course, 1970s, $10,000 was real money. Now it'll get you a tank of gas. But I also realized it was a real heartbreak that the situation, what had happened to Roxbury, the whole social deterioration that had really set in, meant that it was not going to be smart for me to try to raise a family there with the idea that they could just walk out the back door and go over to Horatio Horace Park or head up the hill to Franklin Park or whatever. And it was really a very hard thing to understand and deal with. So I wound up in Cambridge as a young adult. And I'm so pleased to see that Boston, Roxbury, South End is coming back. That we are claiming back from the dark side all these wonderful open spaces and public places where it's now safer to walk, though they still have stinky buses going up Humboldt Avenue. And, all right, I'm going to complain. I admit it, I'm going to complain. The elevated is gone. Now, it's fine for the folks who are, you know, out towards JP, you know, along the Southwest Corridor. I think that's a great solution to the Southwest Corridor. If Frank Sargent were here right now, I'd thank him for standing up against that insane project to have the inner belt or whatever it was going to be called. But they took away the elevated line. And the silver line that goes out there is like, I don't know, maybe a $3 bill. It just doesn't do it. You could really count on public transportation there. You'd get to Dudley, the bus would be right there, and away you go. The Silver Line gets clogged up in traffic, and it's getting there. Although, I have to admit, I do have this Catch the Bus app on my phone to get around town, so that I don't have to speculate exactly. This was, and still is, and is coming back to be, a really wonderful neighborhood. So I came in here tonight, and I have to say I got lost trying to drive into the parking lot. Anybody else have that experience here? I may have gone to Harvard with Ben, but you know, I couldn't figure out this. But I realized that just across the street, my sister had gone to Girls Latin. It was called that back then. I think now the PC is Latin Academy. And I also remember that I had gone to a nursery school up Ruggles Street. This was a walkable, fun part of town. It did not have the edgy element that it still retains sometimes coming from Mission Hill. And there's no reason why we can't go back to that. Now, I think one of the changes that's happened is, not particular to Boston, but this is what's happened to our whole society. So when I was a kid running around Franklin Park, we were an urban society. We hadn't started running out to the suburbs. People used public transportation. People walked. The car hadn't quite taken over. But when the car takes over, then keeping places walkable and available, the priority of that goes down. And while Franklin Park, by the time that I was a kid, you know, Roxbury was a fairly African-American part of town, Franklin Park was diverse in my day. I remember people, all kinds of people at Franklin Park. But as time went on, a lot of white people moved out, kept moving south to Mattapan, went to Milton, and then maybe, I don't know, they go to Rhode Island? I don't know what's that. Certainly, if you heard them in front of the court on the school desegregation, they, oh, well, it's just too far to go. But something else happened. And this is something that's going on in our society. The year 1900, half of America lived on farms. And that meant virtually every household, every family was likely to have a connection to a farm someplace. Not everybody, but likely. Even folks that came up from the South, people of color that came up from the South to Boston, were leaving a rural state. People knew and understood the land. So that when my family or my caretakers would make sure that I would get out to the park, this was a real source of enjoyment for them. This is really great for them to be outside. Nowadays, so many people don't get outside. When you're in the city, you're in this concrete and glass tower. When you go outside, you must curb your dog. It is much more restricted and much less connected to the land. And let me tell you, in my experience, if you're not connected to the land, it's very hard to get connected to what's going on with environmental change. And the park is a key place in the city, anywhere. But the park, because we have wonderful, huge national parks and all, they do really great things. But let me tell you, I would much rather have a Horatio Harris Park within walking distance of every kid than the Grand Canyon. Now, don't get me wrong, I love the Grand Canyon. It's a neat place. I don't get there very often. Kids get to the park if they have the chance. Robert Coles wrote a few years ago that kids living in the city, fully half of those kids living in the city, had never been outside alone in a relatively wild place. The closest they ever got to it was maybe their rooftop. They could go up on the roof and see the stars maybe at night or whatever, to be just by themselves, connected to nature. So we have lost a tremendous amount. And what you folks are doing as part of the Conservancy to protect this heritage and the resource that we have in these parks is really, really, really important. In fact, I'm not overstating the case to say this is key to our survival as a species. Huh? Man, I knew he was going to say something to make us feel good, but that good? Key to the survival of us as a species. Why? Because we are in an environmental emergency. Ben Taylor alluded to some of the work we've done on climate change, climate disruption. When I started this work, a little more than 20 years ago, this was something that was being forecast. Oh, we may see this. Well, let's see, living here in Massachusetts, I think there's still several hundred thousand people without electricity in Connecticut and live towards Worcester and in New Hampshire after this October snowstorm. Maybe we had a tornado this year, did we? There are parts of the country that have had, no water, and then there are parts that have had all kinds of water. We're having 100-year floods. How often? Temperature is rising. You just go down the list. We're in it, folks. We're already in it. And folks who don't get outside, people who don't get outside, who don't understand the rhythm of nature, hey, man, if you're in your air-conditioned car or going in the glass tower, just crank up the air conditioning a bit. So the awareness that people get by being able to get out to a park and just be part of nature is really, really important. But there's more. America is singular as an industrial society for a number of things, but demographically, what's really interesting is that we're the only industrial society whose population is rising and rising rapidly. When this century began, we were at about 300 million people. We're on our way to 450 million people. I think the forecast here is 2042 or something. We're already at 310. That's a huge increase. Much of that increase comes from immigrants and kids of immigrants, recent immigrants. But where are we going to put another 100 million people in America? You know, in Boston, the paradigm has been, population is going down. You know, it's kind of flat. You know, Boston used to be bigger. It's on its way back up. There are going to be more and more folks here. And let me tell you something. It's kind of a secret because the rest of the country hasn't figured this out, but with this climate disruption, this part of the country actually has water. If you go to the southwest, like in Phoenix, Los Angeles, Texas, they're not out of water. So all these people are not only going to be coming to the U.S., but they're going to want to come here, okay? Right? But don't tell them, you know? So, not only more people, but our demographic is changing color-wise, okay? Majority of school kids in this town now are kids of color. African-American, maybe Latino, maybe Asian-American. We're all American, but we're getting to this browner hue. And so it's really important, I think, for this parks movement to make sure, and I love the level of inclusion already here, that really continues. And the way to recruit people is exactly the way they're doing it. Get the young folks, because they're not only going to be the future leaders, they're all going to be, hopefully, voters. They're all going to be making decisions with their own families as to how to live. And right now, our system disconnects them from the land. Right now, you have to take an affirmative step to connect a kid to the land, in this town and in many other towns. And unless we have a population that's really informed about environmental change and the crisis from the climate is just one of these. Although I have to say that if we don't get that right, nothing else really matters. But we have all other sorts of environmental issues that we need to deal with. And unless we have people who are interested and care about it, it's not going to happen. So it's in our best interest to bring everybody into this tent, as many as we can, because one thing about the environment is I can't have a separate one from you. I can kid myself and think, well, you know, my air-conditioned car, doesn't matter how hot it is outside, or I can be in my estate in, anybody here live in Weston? Nobody here lives in Weston? My estate in Weston? But the fact is, this air we're breathing, we all shared that. This water that you might have had tonight when you came in, those molecules have been recycled on this planet over and over and over again. It's the same stuff. So if you want it clean, you got to keep it clean. So we're in this together. One of the neat things, Olmsted books are gone, but I got to talk with the author, Justin, what's his last name?
Martin.
Martin, right, Justin Martin. And I read his book. The cool thing about Frederick Law Olmsted that I had no idea of until I read this book was that he was such a social activist, that he was involved as an abolitionist, that he went with for the New York Times, and they said New York Times, he goes to the South to tell the story of slavery. He says it's inefficient. And what I got from this man, and what Justin Martin really says explicitly, is that here's a guy that when he did the park thing, it was part of his bid for democracy. The parks were the great democratizer. That they're there for everybody. They can't there be just for somebody. So he goes and sees the great estates in Europe, and he gets design ideas from them, but he also notices that the gates are locked. To see some of the places, he had to make arrangements, and how do I get into the Duke's place, and da 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 da. And he says, this doesn't make any sense. Parks need to be for everybody. And so we have to, what are the paradigms that's necessary to go forward to have that access? Is to be sure that in fact, as we think of these parks, and you guys are already thinking of it, that we'll get access. So some of the things that came up tonight, for example, that caught my ear on this, if we're going to have a city, we're going to have a more crowded city, we're going to have more people in this city, it ain't going to work to have cars move us around. So we need more walking, we need more biking, we need better transit to ride if it's a longer distance. And those facilities have to be first class. And you've already started. For example, that overpass by the Arboretum, what's it called, the Casey?
Yeah.
I mean, it's crazy that Franklin Park isn't connected to the Arboretum and you can't get over to the pond area on a bike or a walk or on a horse maybe, I don't know, the Rangers. That you go through this concrete no person's land. If you want to, I mean, take your life in your hands if you try to go. If you try to go through there, and what's crazy is there's a big bus barn, there's a big T sort of dead zone or whatever you want to call it there. But you guys are working to bring that together, and it's so important because once one is able to get on a bike in my old street in Roxbury and bike all the way around the pond, and actually start to come up the necklace into town, this is going to be really, really terrific. So it's something to think about. A couple of things I'll challenge you folks on to consider. One is completely nuts. But, you know, it will be great if every neighborhood in Boston, on the easy days when families and folks are around, that there's an easy shuttle to the parks. Because, you know, there's decent public transportation to sort of on a point basis to various parks, but it's a little tough. If you're a little bit older, you're a little bit younger and such, it'll be really great if down your street or down your avenue, the park shuttle would come and just take you to wherever. And it can be fun, you know, it can move around the city. It doesn't have to be every park, every weekend, all the time. I know this costs money. You guys have oodles of money, so actually this is not impractical. But you can mix it up. The idea is that this is the festival. And this transportation, by the way, should be free. It should be offered free, just like the parks need to be free. Because the investment that we're making by having them free really pays off, because we're going to connect this next generation to the land. And then the other thing that I would suggest you consider is expanding what's become the community garden movement here to make sure that every school has a working garden. Every kid should understand that food does not come out of a cellophane bag, but is grown. Almost. I tell you, almost every Boston school that I've been to, and I went to quite a few back in the day as a, you know, working for the Globe, had some kind of a yard. Most of the time, it was
asphalt,
or maybe concrete. You know, a bomb could go off and you wouldn't know. And it would not be that hard to have raised beds in there. Now, I make this suggestion not out of anything original, but it's some work that we've done in Los Angeles, in South Central Los Angeles, a tough, tough neighborhood. There's a great garden at Crenshaw High School. This is amazing. And so what do you do about the vacations in the summers? Well, seniors are involved. They come and they work in the gardens as well. And it becomes a community resource to be in the garden. Every school in this town, or both towns, we've got Brookline too, every school needs a garden, outside garden space for their kids. So they, everybody will know, at least in a rudimentary way, how food is grown. And plus they'll get to taste really good stuff, because, you know, when you don't ship it 3,000 miles and pick it too early, it just tastes a whole heck of a lot better. So, we have the resources. This is the time. Because I realized that what I do today, the reason as a journalist that I looked up one day in 1989 and I said the environment is the best story going, was because of my exposure. And it started, you know, whatever. I mean, 3, 4, 5, whatever, that I was getting outside and having the outside space and seeing that, in fact, you could. There are all kinds of creatures. I love the giraffes in the park. I love the. But the ordinary places were great fun. And there's plenty of time. We're not out of time yet to do this. But we don't have much time to do it. So I'm pleased that the park paradigm here is being taken beyond the swan boats, although I love going to them too as a kid. Beyond the formal spaces, beyond, you know, we're down at the garden and the common and all this kind of formal stuff, and out into the neighborhoods. I'm thrilled what you're doing with the kids, with the bikes, with, now you have, the gatehouse has become a center. My only disappointment is that I'm not getting an emerald necklace. So for me, this has just been an honor to appear in front of you folks, because it ain't easy work, it's not glorious work, it takes a long time. Just like Olmsted really did not really live to see the full impact of what he had put together, the work that's being done here, we won't, well, even younger folks will have a better shot, but many of us won't really get to see the fruits of the labors that are being put in here, but they will be sweet fruit indeed. Thank you so much.
What do you feel your role of recreational facilities inside parks is? I mean, should be, or is not?
Okay, well, I think it's important to share the facility and to be smart about it ecologically. So, I think it's very important to have recreation areas appropriately in parks, because it gets a lot of people out and it becomes a social thing. I mean, it's important sometimes to be alone or just in a small group in the park, but it's also important to go go and have fun there. So it's, what's behind your question? Is there a controversy?
Well, there are usually competing interests between flora and fauna people and recreational people that, because we have a limited resource, people feel very strongly about preserving one aspect or another of it, or, you know. So I know it's a balancing act. I guess that's probably what you're going to say.
Well, yeah, I mean, like, for example, here we are at the Fenway, so there is a baseball facility a few blocks from here. But no, seriously, this becomes a real opportunity for dialogue. So let's take, say, a playing field. You know, typically, people in the playing field business like to douse these with all kinds of nasty chemicals. It's not actually good for kids to be exposed to that stuff if you're trying to have the grass be perfect. So when you start a dialogue with the folks who are maintaining that and say, well, all right, if we're going to share this space, then we can't be, you know, the nutrients for the grass, you know, the way that we manage this can include a whole range of endocrine disrupting chemicals. Having some flexibility, you're going to laugh at this, but you know, one of the ecological ways of grazing livestock is called rotational grazing. You don't stay in the same place all the time. You move them around. And one thing about recreation facilities is that people sort of want to embed them in places. Well, I think that you might do better ecologically if they float a bit, if they move. Another thing, and this alludes to the transportation gamut that I threw out, if you offer transportation to people easily and openly, so for recreation, let's say that, for example, Franklin Park, you know, White Stadium and all that, just jammed up in that corner and everything, just kind of taken over by that process. Well, if there were other places in the park where this could happen, but it's possible for people to get there without a hassle, you know, that makes it possible. It's zero sum thinking instead of thinking of it as an ecological system and working together to figure out, okay, what do we really need here? What are the most important things, and how can we get there? So yes, a balancing act, but also a cooperative approach. How do we share this? I mean, I think it would be great fun to see baseball, for example, down on the Boston Common. Why not? But okay, great. I haven't seen. Okay. All right. So that's very good.
John,
in your travels as a journalist, where do you see Boston and Brookline fitting in with other cities in terms of the environment and parks and recreation? Are we ahead of the curve, or in the middle, or are we dragging our feet? Do you have a sense of that?
Well, it depends on where. So you talk about the United States, you're talking about the world. Okay. So Boston's actually pretty good. The older cities tend to do better than the younger ones. You know, once the car was really, you know, going full bore, you know, it's tough. I mean, I think particularly of LA and some places that it's kind of tough. Because Boston has, believe it or not, I know if you took the red line today, you don't feel this way, pretty good public transportation system. I took the green line today, and since the governor's no longer governor, I sat for almost 15 minutes outside the government center on the green line, trying to get over here to WBUR from the North Station. So, but seriously, we have pretty good public transportation. So I'd say on the spectrum, Boston is at the higher end. New York obviously is terrific. Philadelphia is strong. Charleston, South Carolina is cool too. But we, you know, I think Boston does well. But that means though that as we do better, it'll be more outstanding. Yes.
Thank you. You mentioned about having guidance in the schools. I think that's a great idea because the teachers could also integrate some of their teaching along with the guiding products. But I would like to suggest that you talk to Carol Johnson, the superintendent of schools, and discuss that possibility. I assume that's not an overly expensive proposition for the school. Just want to mention that to you.
Well, good point. Here's, if I were to put on the school department hat, first of all, I'd say, okay, who's going to pay for this? And then schools have really disconnected themselves from the community. And outsiders aren't all that welcome. So think about giving up some turf to outside folks is a little tricky. But that's overgeneralization. I mean, there's some wonderful schools, especially some of the magnet schools that I think might be a great place to start. And I left out one, I don't know, I'm sorry, my apologies. The other place to do this, are rooftops. There are some places that are totally appropriate. There's some schools that are totally appropriate. I'm thinking of the Snowden School, for example, where thinking rooftop rather than the yard would be a great place to go.
This is an extension of what Assembly said, but we have the fortune of sending our son to a great school in Boston, and the park system in Boston, from the Boston Common through the Fens, all the way through the Auditorium and Franklin Park, was an extended part of the classroom. And it was an initiative of the teachers. It didn't take an act of Congress. And it doesn't need to take an act of Congress to make the park system and the Emerald Necklace a part, an extension of the classroom. I have seen it done. I have experienced it. I have witnessed it. And it can happen in a very good way.
Well, you said that you'd want to get kids to like go to parks instead of like spending time on the inside. Well, like I agree with you, like kids spend more time on the inside on computers and Facebook and whatnot instead of like going outside and spending time outside. As a person who has a garden myself, like even if you did create like recreation centers and like parks and whatnot, and like even if you did create like better parks, how would you plan about getting kids to end their habits of using like Facebook and whatnot in their house and get outside?
Well, so here's the thing. Kids don't really start Facebook at age 2. Kids don't.
It's three.
On the iPad is. If the exposure begins young, and you know, by the way, very young kids don't need a huge park. One of the things that Gary Nabin and Steve Trimble wrote this wonderful book called The Geography of Childhood. It's some of the research that the more popular book, No Child Left, whatever that is, left outside. But the thing is, young kids just need a little tiny space. If there's just, a 2-year-old could, not much bigger than, say, an area rug outside to poke around in. And the space just slowly grows. One thing will happen is that people like to go hiking, right? Young adults, they've got a baby, they've got a backpack, they put the baby in the backpack, they're hiking the baby. And then now the baby's toddling, right? And getting a little bit bigger, and they go out for the hike, and the kids get to the trailhead, and they say, That's developmentally completely appropriate. They should just hang out at the trailhead and play in that, fifth of an acre or a quarter acre, half acre, and just have fun right there. Squish their toes in the mud and all that right there. And so if you start early enough, then the allure of, the video game and Facebook and Twitter and all that is going to be balanced. I have a son who's a kind of a computer geek, but he has to get outside. He has to get outside. He'll spend time on the swing, but he has to get outside because he got it early enough. So I think that's the answer. For the generation that missed that, well, we can work on them. We can work on it. But we need to have the space be friendly. And back to the thing about the food. You know, everybody eats, not as much as maybe I do, but everybody eats. And so connecting people of all ages to what you can do with gardening and food and ornamentals and all that is really powerful for all ages, right up, you know, very young to very old. This is something that people get into. Then maybe they'll know more than 10 species.
Right. Please, one last question.
There are just two observations. One is I've often thought that there should be a shuttle bus that goes from the Children's Museum to the aquarium and all the way up to Franklin Park into the zoo, because it's really, it's awkward to get out to Franklin Park. And I've lived in Boston for about 35 years. And a couple of weekends ago, I went on this thing called the Tweed Bicycle Ride, and we went along the Emerald Necklace, and I've never really done the complete Emerald Necklace, and we went all the way out to Franklin Park, which I saw was this really cool park, but it's not really comfortable for bicycling on. It's got the path, it's like broken up in places, and there's some drops and such. And so I would like to know when and if that there's going to be a nice, you know, it's going to be easy to ride the whole Emerald Necklace all the way out to Franklin Park and fulfill the vision of Frederick Law. So I'd like to know, I'd like to be involved in trying to get that.
That's such a powerful suggestion because you know, the Minuteman bike trail that goes from Somerville up in, on the weekend up to Bedford, it's jammed.
That's right. You can't get your car and go out there. I'm here.
You can't move, you know, between the strollers and the rollerbladers and never mind the walkers and runners, but the thing is jammed. So if we had that continuity in town, it would be very busy.
And there were no bikers by the time you got out to Franklin Park. And it's just this beautiful park. It's everyone here, I'm sure.
It is the vision of Circle the City. It is our vision. And the Route 9 crossing is important to that vision. Hopefully the removal of the Casey overpass is important to that vision. Some new repaving, some fixing of access points is part of that vision. So we're working on it and we'd love to have your help. And our public partners are working on it with us. And Patrice Kish is here from DCR. We're working on a pathway and crosswalk treatment study with DCR and Patrice's help and one of our funders here. This is big on our agenda. It's not going to happen overnight, but it's on our agenda in a big way. So love to have you involved.
Steve, thank you so much.